Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Skeletons of Scarborough House, an absolutely hilarious cosy mystery by Kitty French, narrated by Cat Gould. Chapter 1.
So, what do you do with your spare time, Melody?
I look my date square in his pretty brown eyes and lie to him. Oh, you know, the usual. I shrug to convey how incredibly normal I am. I read a lot, go to the movies, that kind of thing. I watch Lenny digest my words and breathe a sigh of relief when his eyes brighten.
Which genre?
Movies or books? I ask, stalling for time because, in truth, I don't get much in the way of spare time to do either.
Movies. Action or romance? No, let me guess.
He narrows his eyes and studies me intently.
You look like a sucker for a rom-com.
Do I? I'm genuinely surprised. I'm 5'3" and look more like Wednesday Addams than a Disney princess. Maybe Wednesday Addams is over-egging it, but you get the idea. I'm brunette, and my dress sense errs on the side of edgy. I don't think anyone has ever looked at me and thought whimsy. Maybe Lenny sees something everyone else has missed, me included. I quite like that idea, mainly because everyone who knows my family has a head full of preconceptions about me, based on the fact that my family are all crackers.
For weddings?
He shrugs hopefully. I nod, not mentioning that the only part of that particular movie I enjoyed was the funeral.
The holiday.
Again, I try to look interested and hold my tongue, because I'm sure he doesn't want to hear that I'd rather stick needles in my eyes than ever watch an over-optimistic Kate Winslet drag some old guy around a swimming pool again. I'm relieved when the bill arrives and we can get out of here, because so far Lenny has turned out to be a pretty stellar guy, and somehow I've managed to convince him that I walk on the right side of the tracks. Maybe this time things will be different. Lenny pulls his dull salesman's saloon into the cobbled cartway beside my building and kills the engine. I don't mind dull. In fact, my life could really use a bit of dull right now. So I shoot him my most seductive smile, cross my fingers that my mother will be in bed, and invite him in for coffee. Ah, just when it had all been going so well. Why couldn't I have just given him a goodnight kiss, with maybe the smallest hint of tongue as a promise, then sent him on his way? He'd have called for a second date, I'm sure of it. But no, I got greedy, pulled him by the hand through the dark back door, placing my finger against my lips to signal he should be quiet as we tiptoed past my mother's apartment and up the old wooden staircase to my place. He rests his hand on my waist as I turn the key, and a small thrill shoots down my back. Look at me, winning at this being an adult thing today. Dinner with an attractive man, sparkling conversation, and now back to mine for coffee. Maybe even a little fooling around. It's not that I'm a virgin or anything, but it would be fair to call my love life patchy of late. By of late, I mean the last 2 years, ever since Leo Dark and I called things off. Well, by Leo and I mean Leo called things off, citing conflict of interests. Huh. Given that he was referring to the fact that my mad as a bag of cats family are the only other psychics in town besides him, he was, at least in part, right. But enough of Leo and my lamentable love life. Right now, all I want is for Lenny not to know anything at all about my peculiar family, to keep seeing me as a cool, regular, completely normal girl, and then to kiss me.
You remind me of Clara Oswald,
Lenny whispers behind me at the top of the stairs.
All big brown eyes and clever one-liners. It's very sexy.
Lord, I think he's just brushed a kiss against the back of my neck. My door sticks sometimes, so I shoulder it open, aiming for firm and graceful, but I fear ending up looking more like a burly police SWAT guy ramming it down. Thankfully, Lenny seems to take it in his stride and follows me into my apartment. Then I flick on the table lamp, only to discover that my mother is standing on my coffee table in a too short, too sheer, baby blue negligee with her arms raised towards the ceiling and her head thrown back.
Shit!
Lenny swears down my ear, clearly startled,
He isn't to blame. My mother's a striking woman, ballerina tall and slender, with silver hair that falls in waves well beyond her shoulder blades. It isn't grey. It's been pure silver since the day she was born. And right now, she looks as if she's just been freshly crucified on my coffee table. I sigh as I drop my bag down by the lamp. So much for me being normal. Mother? Slowly, she takes several heaving breaths and opens her eyes, changing from crazy lady to almost normal human lady. She stares at us.
For God's sake, Melody,
she grumbles, taking her hands from above her head and planting them on her hips.
I almost had the connection then.
He's hiding out in the loft, I'm sure of it. I risk a glance over my shoulder at Lenny, who sure isn't kissing my neck anymore. He lifts his eyebrows at me, a silent, what the hell, and then looks away when my mother beckons to him like a siren, luring a fisherman onto the rocks. Your hand, please, young man.
No,
I almost yell, but Lenny is already across the room with his hand out to help her down. My mother eyes me slyly as she steps from the table, keeping a firm hold of Lenny's hand.
Long lifeline, she murmurs,
tracing her red talon across Lenny's palm.
Mother,
I warn, but my somber, cautionary tone falls on her selectively deaf ears. I expected nothing else, because she's pulled this trick before. Admittedly, the standing on the table thing is a new twist, but she's got form in scoping out my prospective boyfriends to make sure they'll fit in with our screwball family from the outset. Not that her romantic gauge is something to put any stock in. Leo passed her tests with flying colours, and look how that ended up. I got my heart broken, and he got a spot on morning TV as the resident psychic. Where's the justice in that? Look, we may as well get the clanky old skeleton out of the family closet early on here, people. It's going to come out sooner or later, and despite my attempts to pull the wool over Lenny's eyes, there's never any running away from this thing for long. My name's Melody Bittersweet, and I see dead people. It's not only me. I'm just the latest in a long line of bittersweets to have the gift, or the curse, depending on how you look at it. My family has long since celebrated our weirdness, hence the well-established presence of our family business, Blythe Spirits, on Chapelwick High Street. We've likely been here longer than the actual chapel at the far end of the street. That's probably why, by and large, we're accepted by the residents of the town in a, they're a bunch of eccentrics, but they're our bunch of eccentrics kind of way. What began as a tiny mullion-windowed one-room shop has spread out along the entire row over the last 200 years. We now own a run of three terraced properties, haphazardly knocked into one big, rambling place that is both business and home to not only me, but also to my mother, Silvana, and her mother, Dicey. Gran's name isn't actually Dicey, it's Paradise, officially, but she's gone by Dicey ever since she met my grandpa Duke on her 15th birthday, and he wrote Dicey and Duke inside a chalk heart on the back wall of the building. He may as well have written it on her own racing heart.
Silvana?
Speak of the devil. Does no one go to bed around here? I open my door to find Gran on the threshold with her hand raised, poised to knock. I guess I should be glad she's slightly more respectably dressed. If a floor-length, purple-shot silk kimono bearing huge technicolor dragons could be considered as such. Her usually pin-curled gold hair is piled elegantly on her head, and she wears a slash of fire-engine scarlet lipstick for good measure. Most people couldn't carry the look off, but thanks to her poise, confidence, and couldn't-care-less attitude, my gran wears it with artful success. She glides past me without invitation and gazes at my mother and Lenny, who are still hand-in-hand on the rug.
God.
First thing tomorrow morning, I swear, I'm going to look for a new place to live, somewhere, anywhere, that is not in the same building as my mother and my gran. Don't get me wrong, it's a charming old place, and I love my family dearly. It's not even as if I don't have my own space here, because, theoretically at least, I do.
Mum and Gran have the ground floor apartment behind Blythe Spirits, and I have the smaller flat upstairs, at the back. In lots of ways, this makes me fortunate. I get to have a nice little home of my own and stay close to my family. It would all be fine and dandy were it not for the fact that my family are officially bonkers and liable to come up and let themselves into my flat, using the spare key I gave them for dire emergencies only, and embarrass the shit out of me. Why is Sylvana entertaining a man half her age in your flat? Gran looks from me to my mother. You should have said you were expecting company, darling. I'd have gone out. She touches her hand lightly against her hair. Put a towel on the doorknob or something. Isn't that the modern way to signal these things? Don't come a knockin' if the caravan's rockin'. She looks spectacularly pleased with herself, and one glance at Lenny tells me that he knows he's way out of his depth with these two, and is in the process of writing me off as the worst date he's ever had. His eyes slide from me to the door, and I can almost hear him begging me to let him go unharmed. He's not Mum's date, he's mine. Or else he was, I mutter, and then I'm distracted as a beer-bellied pensioner in a soup-stained shirt slowly materializes through the ceiling, his flannel trousers not quite meeting his bony ankles. Stay with me. I see dead people, remember? As do my mother and my grandmother, who also watch him descend with matching expressions of distaste. Finally, my mother spits, dropping Lenny's hand so she can round on the new arrival. 2 hours I've been chasing you around this bloody building. Your wife wants to know what you've done with the housekeeping she'd hidden in the green teapot. She says you better not have lost it on the horses, or she's had it with you. My gran rolls her eyes. I rather think she's had it with him anyway. He's been dead for 6 weeks. You're a fine one to talk, given that you still sleep with your husband 20 years after he died. Mother flicks her silver hair sharply. Touché. Lenny whimpers and bolts for my front door, turning back to me just long enough to splutter, "Something's come up. Gotta go." Before he hoofs it out and down the stairs 2 at a time. I listen to the outside door bang on its hinges and wonder what came up. Probably his dinner. Breakfast, darling. The following morning, my mother acts as if nothing untoward happened last night when I stomp barefoot into the warm, farmhouse-style kitchen she shares with Gran. It's a double standard, I know. I moan about them letting themselves into my flat and then breeze into theirs as if I own the place. But in my defense, it's totally my mother's fault. She props their door open and then lures me down the stairs with the smell of home cooking, usually something sweet and irresistible. I think she's actually found a way to pump the smell of freshly made waffles through the ancient heating system in the building. It's like a siren she knows I cannot ignore. Sugar alert, sugar alert, melody bittersweet, report to your mother's cozy kitchen for sweet fabulousness and a grilling on your love life immediately. You can't get round me with waffles this time, I grouch. I'd spent most of the night before tossing and turning, thinking about the fact that my life is heading precisely nowhere and something drastically needs to change. Where's Gran? She's behind you. I turn at the sound of Gran's stage school animal growl and find her standing right behind me making big bad wolf claw hands in the air for her own amusement. Resplendent once more, in embroidered purple silk, she pours herself a stiff black coffee and takes a seat at the scrubbed pine kitchen table. I'm glad you're both here, I say, pulling up one of the mismatched chairs and squirting syrup onto the waffles I'd said I didn't want. I heap a few fresh blueberries to stave off my sugar guilt. There's something I need to tell you. You're pregnant at last? Gran clasps her hands in shiny-eyed anticipation. Given the fact that you two terrify any prospective boyfriends, it's hardly likely, is it? Mother looks sanguine beside the aga she had installed to complete her farmhouse kitchen fantasy. Marry a woman, marry her family. I grit my teeth as thoughts of my own Miss Havisham-style fate strengthen my resolve. I'm starting a business. The pair of them swivel their heads and stare at me with widened eyes. I suddenly feel very on the spot. In the empty room, beneath my flat, I press on. Blythe Spirits is so big that several rooms have fallen into disuse, and the big one at the back on the ground floor is perfect for my new enterprise. It has its own door out onto the cobbled alleyway, which can serve as public access, and there's a big open fireplace in there to keep it warm and cozy through the chilly months. Technically, it's in my bit of the building anyway, so I don't expect to have to put up much of a fight for it. But that's my stockroom, Mother says, pausing with the frying pan in her hand. I shoot her a sarcastic look. You don't keep any stock. She can't argue with me. We deal in the dead. They don't need shelf space. I've been known to hold a séance in there once or twice, Gran throws in airily. Yes, and the last time you said you would never do it again because the room has negative energy. I rather suspect it was more the fact that the séance was conducted at the behest of the local bridge club, and Gran was bored stupid by both the living participants and the dullest dishwater spirits they attracted. No matter, her negative energy claims suit my purposes today. I'm 27, I reason. It's time I stood on my own 2 feet. My mother looks pointedly under the table at my black and white polka dot painted toenails and the ankle chain adorned with silver stars, clearly doubting that my feet are appropriate for, or capable of, business.
What will you do?
Gran asks, wrinkling her nose at the waffles my mother offers her, and delicately piercing a blueberry with the tips of her fork instead. She is whippet thin and eats like a bird, preferring to save her calories for the champagne she's rarely seen without. When she dies, if she ever dies, it's always 5 o'clock somewhere, will be engraved on her tombstone. Here goes nothing.
Ghostbusting?
I mumble, shoving a mouthful of waffle into my face as I study my plate.
What was that, Melody?
Gran says, leaning in across the table. My mother, whose hearing is pin sharp, narrows her suddenly suspicious eyes at me.
Yes, she says silkily. Say it again, Melody. Only louder.
She barks the last word out to demonstrate. I sigh heavily and clear my throat. I'm going to open an agency to help people get rid of unwanted ghosts. Gran clutches the lapels of her purple kimono in wide-eyed shock.
Get rid of them?
She looks to my mother for support.
Sylvana, are you hearing this?
It's not all that different to what we already do, I explain, trying to put a positive spin on it. Our family represent the interests of the deceased, not the living, Melody. That's what we do, Mum says with a frown. She makes it sound like an advert for a family law firm for the recently departed, and I bite back the obvious response, which is that actually, Blythe Spirits makes a handsome profit from representing the needs of the living far more than the dead, namely in acting as the conduit between the two. We keep the lines of communication open, sort of like an astral telephone exchange, and therefore, we need the ghosts to stick around. So, yeah, I kind of expected my plans to go down like a cup of cold sick. I know that, I say, keeping my voice deliberately steady and calm. But you both know that I'm not like you, or like most of our ancestors either.
You're a bittersweet, Melody. You see them, just like the rest of us,
Gran says, chewing on another blueberry.
Yes, I do see them. I do, but the difference between you and me is that I don't particularly want to see them. I find it bloody inconvenient that they pop up everywhere I go. I don't want to spend my time finding out what Great Aunt Alice meant by that weird thing she said on her deathbed, or passing messages from disgruntled wives about housekeeping money missing from green teapots.
My mother looks at me pithily. I know it was a cheap shot. She deserved it after that stunt she pulled on my coffee table last night.
Belittling the valuable service we offer isn't big or clever, Melody Bittersweet. All right, maybe I shouldn't have said the thing about the teapot, Mum. I know you provide an important service, and that's great, but it's not for me.
I turn to Gran. But you're right, too. I cover her bejeweled hand with my own in an attempt to win her over. I see them. I see them everywhere. So much so that there's no point in even trying to get a normal job anymore. They can't argue with this, because any job I've held down outside of the family business has always gone spectacularly wrong. My stint as a solicitor's assistant ended abruptly, because the solicitor in question's dead mother was in residence and wouldn't give me a minute's peace to get any work done. She badgered him relentlessly with messages, mostly to do with the fact that she didn't approve of his torrid affair with his secretary. I can't say I did either, but unlike his mother, I preferred to keep my opinion to myself. It came to a head when I found myself loudly telling her to knob off, and that her son's affair with his secretary was neither my business nor hers, which would probably have been okay had it not been for the fact that his wife had just turned up to take him to lunch as a surprise and heard every word. Suffice to say, the solicitor soon needed a solicitor of his own. Then there was the time I landed a job as a dental nurse and found myself accompanied by the long-deceased dentist who'd opened the practice decades before and couldn't seem to let go. He was constantly in my way as I worked and wholly responsible for the fact that I prepped the dentist the wrong set of new enamels for Chapelwick's MP and inadvertently turned him into Mr. Ed. He still blames me for the fact that he lost his seat in the next election. This way, I'll be providing a service to the dead, too, just not in the same way you do. Can't you see that, Gran? You and Mum, you're like a ghoul telephone exchange. What I'm going to be is more of a... I cast around for a suitable definition. Ghoul dispatcher? My mum is not one to be easily won over. I shrug, exasperated. If you like, yes. It's not how I'd choose to put it. But we all know that ghosts get stuck sometimes and need help to move on. So you're going to meddle? Bittersweets don't meddle. That's not our job. I take in the stubborn set of my mother's mouth. It's clear that if I hold out for her approval, I'll never get this business off the ground. Gran? Both me and my mum look at our family elder. She spears another blueberry and pops it in her mouth, chewing it slowly, even though she's more than aware that we're both waiting for her verdict. It's obvious where my mother gets her dramatic bent. Gran fixes me with her beady eyes and eventually points her fork at me. This won't affect the family firm in any negative way. We do rather depend on the ghosts being around, darling. Not a bit. These would be ghosts who've got stuck here or are causing trouble. You won't even know I'm there. Promise. I shake my head and hold my breath as I silently draw a cross over my heart. She chews another blueberry while she contemplates, and then lays her fork down carefully. Champagne, Silvana. It looks like our baby is going into business. I can't keep the grin from my face and only resist the urge to hug her because Mum has gone silent, and the way she's staring at me is unnerving. Is this because of the 27-years-old thing again? She asks, soft and perceptive. I flick my eyes quickly away from hers at the mention of my recent birthday. She really is way too good at this Mum stuff for me to be able to fool her. Because we've been through this, she says. It's just a number. No more, no less. 27 might be just a number to some people, but not to me. 27 is the age my mum was when she gave birth to me, and the age my gran was when she gave birth to my mother. It was also the age my father was on the day he died, his motorbike crushed beneath the wheels of a lorry as he dashed to the hospital to be with my mum when she gave birth. Turning 27 myself, then, hit me harder than I'd imagined. I'd got up expecting a pretty normal sort of birthday, and found myself hit with the most enormous, lung-crushing case of, oh my God, what am I doing with my life? It literally stopped me in my tracks, a great big juggernaut of fear and emotion and actual tears. I thought of my mother and how she'd already found her love, her calling, and had a child by this age. I thought of my father, The man whom my mother has never gotten over losing. The man whose life ended at this point, when my life has barely even got off the starting blocks. Up until the age of 26 and 364 days, I was a child playing at being a grown-up. But on the afternoon of my 27th birthday, I metaphorically put away my childish things, and I made a list. I want a life that's good, a life that's full and rich with love and pride, to make things happen for myself, rather than have them happen to me. I don't care how many failed dates it takes. I'm going to keep on kissing frogs and risking my heart until I find the man who will cup it in his hands and care for it always. And regardless of the fact that it scares the living daylights out of me, I'm going to start my own agency. And I'd really love to do it with my mum's blessing. Gran comes to my rescue with an unexpected suggestion.
She can have Glenda in there for a couple of hours each morning, Sylvana.
Glenda Jackson is the secretary, centre of the universe at Blythe Spirits, a veritable wonder woman when it comes to organisation. She's been at Blythe for as long as I can remember, the kind of woman who could run the world in her spare time if she chose to. Luckily for us, she concentrates all of her efforts on keeping our ship tight, far too tight to need me as an assistant, which, having given up all attempts at working as a civilian, has been my most recent job. I was entirely redundant here, to be honest. My mother and Gran are happy to devote their time and energy to individual sittings and group sessions, and Glenda has the admin and organisational side of things stitched up tighter than a kipper. It smooths the wheels for us that she is well respected in Chapelwick. She adds an air of normality to our screwball, let's talk to the ghosts business. She's also the keeper of the Chapelwick jungle drums. If Glenda doesn't know something, it's not worth knowing. It's a masterstroke by Gran. Offering me Glenda's services gives my mother a way to keep tabs on what I'm up to, and gives me a way to get what I want. You don't live in this family for as long as Gran has without learning diplomatic skills that could rival Switzerland. My mother looks a tiny bit mollified, but anyone who didn't know her well wouldn't have been able to spot the thaw. She huffs her cheeks out and scowls at Gran. You can't have champagne. It's breakfast time. Gran shrugs her shoulders delicately, thoroughly unrepentant.
It's 5 o'clock somewhere, Sylvana.
Chapter 2.
What was I thinking? I don't have a clue how to run a business. It's all going to be terrible, and I'm doomed to be a horrible failure. Even the ghosts will laugh at me.
I drop like a sack of spuds into the overstuffed armchair beside the fireplace in my new office and almost disappear into the cloud of dust that billows from it. It's only been 2 days since I revealed my grand plan, and already the nerves are kicking in hard.
Jesus Christ. Melody!
Marina picks up the deflated bubblegum from between her lips and drops it in the bin, rather than take it back into her mouth, coated in dust. My best friend on the planet since infant school. Marina and I bonded over the fact that we both wore braces and came from families that marked us as outsiders, no matter how hard we tried to hide it. She has her grandmother's Sicilian heritage to thank for her curvy Italian beauty, and her grandfather's Sicilian business skills to thank for the Malone family wealth and fearsome reputation. She'd turned 19 before she lost her virginity, because she was a curious mix of knockout and terrifying that made teenage boys nervous. Once the cloud of dust from the old chair clears, she looks at me steadily from her perch on the desk she spent the last hour patiently polishing up from grotty to usable.
One, it's not going to be terrible, and you're not doomed to failure.
She counts on her fingers to give me a visual aid.
Two, so what if you don't know how to run a business? You're a fast learner, and you've got Glenda Jackson for 2 hours every morning. That woman could run the country in her lunch hour.
I'm slightly bolstered, because that is actually a fact. Back when we were in school, Glenda oversaw our revision timetables with a beadier eye than Anna Wintour keeps on her junior staff. We both aced our exams, and it was entirely because we were terrified of her.
I'm three,
Marina chews on a fresh stick of gum and holds up three fingers.
Who gives a fuck if the ghosts laugh at you? They're dead, and you're not, so you automatically win. Besides, they won't be laughing when you suck them up with your ghost hoover, or whatever it is you're going to use.
I laugh despite myself. It's not that, but thank you. I wish I could wake up with even a fifth of Marina's couldn't-give-a-stuff attitude. Do you think I should get my hair cut into something that says, serious businesswoman? I ask, and she shoots me a look that says, have you lost your mind?
You've had the same hairstyle since we were in school,
she laughs.
You own that bob, Melody. It's way too late to change the system now.
The system? She wafts her hand at me.
You're always going to be the short, cute as a button one with big brown eyes and cherry-flavoured lip gloss, and I'm always going to be the slightly slutty one with too much hair, red lipstick and a bad attitude. We go together. You cannot cut your hair. It would fuck with the system.
The system is new to me, but when I consider it, she's right. It's taken us a decade to perfect our look, and for that we've earned the right to rock it for as long as we damn well choose. Besides, there's no way I can go through life without cherry lip gloss. It keeps me going in between sugar fixes. The bob stays. I might not be changing my look, but the office has had a complete overhaul, and even if I do say so myself, it's looking pretty swish. With the obvious oversight of the grubby chair I'm sitting on, it's been mopped, polished, and vacuumed to within an inch of its life. And my start-up budget had run as far as a new magenta swivel chair for my clients to sit in, and one of those fancy slatted blinds that all officers have to have in order to be considered professional. I've avoided the obvious. No Columbo-style Mac stand or yucca plant skimming the ceiling. No heavy glass ashtrays overflowing with cigar stubs. This place is functional, with what I'd like to call a feminine touch, right down to the jug of fresh tulips on the coffee table in the relaxation area. The relaxation area! I know! Get me in my areas. It's actually just a little flop-out sofa and an old wimback chair grouped around the fireplace and TV. But it counts as relaxing, right? I'm aiming for urban chic, or at the very least, something that doesn't scream boho ghost hunter. There will be no hippy-dippy incense burning in this office.
Maybe you should get an incense burner, Marina grins, and I let my middle finger do the talking for me.
She shrugs and slides from the desk, blowing me a kiss as she makes to leave.
Gotta shoot, places to be.
I know that means she needs to get back to take over caring for her elderly grandpa while her mother works. Marina's family is big on family loyalty.
You'll come back on Monday morning, though. You think I'd be late for my first morning at work?
She rolls her eyes.
9 o'clock, you and me. Ghostbusting girls are a go. It's gonna be bloody brilliant.
She throws me a wink as she skips out the door, calling,
I'll bring donuts,
over her shoulder as she disappears. I listen to her fast footsteps recede over the cobbles and send up a silent thank you to her last boss for firing her a couple of weeks back. I don't know the full details, because this isn't the first time she's been let go. I expect Marina is one of those people who doesn't do so well with being bossed around, even if the person giving the orders is her boss and supposed to tell her what to do. She wasn't especially distressed about being let go. She doesn't work because she needs the money as much as because she needs to get out of the family nest. She practically invited herself to come and work at the agency, and boy, was I going to be glad of the company and the support. So, that makes three. Marina, Glenda Jackson, and me. I know Glenda's only doing a couple of hours a day, but believe me when I say that there's no need to count that as part-time where Glenda's concerned. God, I'm knackered. This chair might be dusty, but it's pretty comfortable. And I lean my head against the side wing and close my eyes. I'm just drifting pleasantly into a dream where Robert Downey Jr., suited up as Iron Man, is on his knees proposing to me, when someone coughs pointedly. I haven't heard the door open, so I keep my eyes firmly closed and sigh. Unless you're devastatingly handsome with eyes like hazelnut espresso, rapier-sharp wit, and are hopelessly in love with me, go away. There's silence, and then,
I'm bald, 62, and I died 3 weeks ago in a freak accident, but I'll give it a go if it means you'll sit up and listen.
I groan and open my eyes to see an aging bald guy standing by the fireplace in a high-vis jacket. He has ruddy cheeks for a dead man, probably a drinker when he was alive. You had me at freak accident, I grumble. Who are you, and what do you want?
Arthur Elliot.
He extends his hand, and we both stare at it, and then he slowly withdraws it when he realizes that I can't shake it. Rookie mistake, I tell him. What was the freak accident? Arthur shakes his head and studies his heavy polished boots.
Worked for the brewery. Barrel fell on my head in the yard.
That explains the high-vis vest, then. I hold back from asking him if he'd been drinking the barrel's contents at the time. Okay, so that covers how you came to be dead. What it doesn't tell me is what you're doing in my new office. He looks around the room, nodding with approval.
Very nice it is, too.
I've met enough ghosts to know that they usually want something, so his attempt at flattery doesn't get him far with me. I fold my arms across my chest and eye him steadily.
Fine,
he says, stroking a hand over his bald head.
I went up front first to talk to Dicey, and she suggested I come talk to you.
My gran sent you? What was she playing at? It's not part of my business plan for her to send ghosts my way if she can't be bothered to pass their messages on herself. Arthur nods.
It's about my lad, Arthur, see?
You and your son are both called Arthur? I say, distracted. Wasn't that confusing at home? He shakes his head.
The wife called me Big Art, and him Little Art. Worked fine until he grew to 6'2".
He smiles sadly.
No need now, I don't suppose. He'll probably be just Art.
I nod, sympathetic, still unsure where I fit into the story of Big Art, Little Art. And you've come to see me about Little Art because? I prompt. Because Big Art has gone misty-eyed, and I know what's likely to happen next if I don't keep him on track. He's freshly dead, which means he's probably still getting used to the idea and prone to emotional outbursts.
Just Art,
he reminds me morosely, wiping a hand across his eyes even though he's incapable of crying. I nod and mutter quickly, Art. Call me uncharitable, but there's a slim chance that if I can hurry Big Art along, I might be able to close my eyes and catch hold of the coattails of my RDJ fantasy. Iron Man could still be on one knee waiting for my answer somewhere in my dreams, but he's not the kind of superhero to hang around for long.
He needs a job, like.
I narrow my eyes, starting to see where this is headed. I'm going to kill my gran. Art needs a job? Big Art nods.
He knows nothing about ghosts, of course, but he's a good lad, and his mother worries about him. We both do, matter of fact. Think that's why I got stuck here instead of going over. Bit of a shame, really. It's my dear old mother's birthday today, and I thought I'd surprise her, seeing as I've not laid eyes on her for 15 years or more. Do they have birthday parties up there?
I try to keep the conversation on track. I'm not taking on staff, I'm afraid. He lifts his eyebrows.
Your gran said you would be. Just someone to carry your bags and make tea, that kind of thing.
Art looks at me as beseechingly as a dead alcoholic in a high-vis can.
You won't have to pay him much. His mother keeps him well fed, just enough to cover his bus fare. And pay for mice for his snake, and he'll be a happy lad. You won't find anyone more willing.
Look, Big Art, I'm practicing my diplomacy skills. If I was in the market for a trainee, Art would be first in the queue. But I'm not.
I'll keep him in mind for the future, okay? Big Art's face falls.
I've failed him. My only son, and I've gone and left him, haven't I?
Try not to blame yourself, I reason. It's sheer bad luck to have a barrel fall on your head. You can't predict these things. He puts both his hands on his head.
Bloody hurt it did.
I imagine it would, yes.
Write his name down in case you get a vacancy.
I'll remember it. Little Arthur Elliot.
You don't know where he lives.
Resigned, I get up from the comfort of the armchair and cross to sit behind my desk, where I open up the wide drawer. Marina has laid out all of my new stationery, as if it's the first day of term. Fresh A4 writing pad, pristine and lined, ready to go. Sharpened pencils, unused eraser, a neat line of blue, black, and red pens. God, I love that woman. I pick up the pad and a pencil and write Arthur Elliot across the top of the paper. I transcribe the address Big Art relays to me, and then smile, my pencil poised. I'm quite enjoying the feeling of writing things down at the desk. It feels like an actual job. Anything else I should know? Qualifications, that sort of thing? I chew the end of the pencil and glance at Big Art, who once more looks on the verge of unsheddable tears.
None,
he whispers. None, I say far louder. Not even an F in woodwork or something.
Bloody bullies.
The words burst from Big Art's chest.
Gentle giant my Artie is, and they just wouldn't leave him alone. Always on the outside he was, never included. Me and his mother didn't even know anything about it until we were called in to see why his attendance was so awful.
He was bullied. Big Art nods.
Summit rotten. Belt his acne, his snake, his height. You know how it is with that sort, like a pack of dogs with a bone. He'd have been all right if he'd had a mate or two, but he never really seemed to find anyone.
No one understands the loneliness of being an outsider more than I do. If I hadn't had Marina, my own school life could very easily have mirrored Little Art's. I look at the mournful, ruddy-cheeked man in front of me and withdraw some proper writing paper from the desk drawer. Come and sit down, Art. Half an hour later and he's a changed ghost. Together we've written a letter to Arthur Elliot Jr., offering him the position of apprentice ghost hunter, stating he's been highly recommended and that he should come at his earliest convenience and identify himself to Melody Bittersweet, sole proprietor of the Girls Ghostbusting Agency on Chapelwick High Street. The name has been a subject of hot debate over the last week between Marina and me. She made a strong case for the Girls Ghostbusting Agency, though I do still fear customers will expect us to turn up in god-awful white jumpsuits and suck their offending ghosts into tanks on our backs. Big Art beams approvingly at the letter as I fold it in half.
Little Art loves Harry Potter. The mystery of it will appeal to him.
I'm afraid I don't have an owl to deliver it, I say, licking a stamp and fixing it on the front of the envelope. In front of me, Big Art is already starting to fade. Seems like you might make your mum's birthday after all, I whisper.
Look after him for me.
I'll try, I say, carried away by the sentiment. I place the letter in the out tray to post later on. Look at me, using my out tray. I pause for a second to soak in the mini thrill of working at my desk for the first time. And then on second thoughts, I pull the envelope out of the out tray and scrawl, "The management regret to inform you that reptiles are not permitted on the premises," across the bottom in red capitals. Eternal promise or not, if Arthur Elliot turns up here with a python, he won't make it past the front door. Chapter 3. I forgot the donuts. It's 2 minutes before 9, and I stare at Marina aghast, then lay my head on the desk. We're doomed. She laughs and pulls a pretty vintage Amaretti Virginia biscuit tin from her huge handbag as she shrugs out of her jacket. Will these do instead? Nona made them fresh this morning, especially for you. I groan happily. I love your gran so much more than I love my own. The closest mine ever gets to sticky buns is at her exercise class. I lift the lid from the glitzy lime green and gold tin and gaze happily at the shiny wonder of Nona Maloney's glazed buns. I sniff the scented air pleasurably. Lemon? Limoncello babars. The heavenly smells that usually permeate the bricks and mortar of Marina's home fill the office, sweet and comforting, and I wonder if 9 in the morning is too early to start mainlining sugar. Marina makes the decision for me by putting the lid back on the tin and moving it a safe distance away from me. She knows me well. I've got no stop valve when it comes to sweet things. I'd happily eat the whole tin of babars and then slump in a heap under the desk by mid-morning. Any word from Little Art? I shake my head. Not yet. It's only been 2 days, though, if you don't count the weekend. That letter probably freaked him right out, to be fair. If he's got any sense, he'll be hiding in the cupboard under his stairs. Marina grins, draping herself sideways over our now thankfully dust-free armchair. She's clocked into work wearing black skinny jeans and a black polka-dot chiffon blouse, her dark waves loose around her shoulders. I look down at my own outfit, indigo skinnies and a long-sleeved navy and white Breton t-shirt. I knotted a red silk scarf around my neck at the last minute, and between us, I think we're channeling an air of jaunty Parisian chic. The only marked difference between our look is that Marina is wearing her signature sky-high heels, and I'm in my equally signature flats. My closet full of ballet pumps and Converse trainers brings me as much joy as other women get from their jewellery boxes. It's not that freaky an offer, is it? I find it difficult to judge weirdness effectively. My idea of what constitutes wacko is skewed by the fact that I grew up in Screwball Central. Marina pulls a face that says, yes, it was possibly the freakiest letter anyone in the whole of Chapelwick has ever received. You're working here, and you're normal, I point out, even though Marina isn't really all that regular. When she doesn't answer me, I narrow my eyes and think, Glenda! I almost punch the air as I shout her name. Glenda's normal. Marina's laugh drips sarcasm. Glenda's freaking Wonder Woman. She probably wears a knickers over her tights underneath those close-fitting little power suits. That's the other thing about Glenda Jackson. She's foxy, literally. All swept-up red hair and va-va-voom bosoms. We have to keep her away from elderly men with weak hearts in case she dispatches them on the spot and gets Blythe a reputation for drumming up business in the most direct way possible. We both jump as someone taps, feather light on the door. God, I hope that's not Glenda. If she heard me, she'll eat my head without even needing to chew, Marina whispers. Shouldn't be. She doesn't start until next week. I asked Gran for a week's grace so we can at least pretend we know what we're doing. In a week? Whoever's at the door taps again, just as softly, and Marina hoists herself up and answers it with her hand on her hip. The girls' ghostbusting agency. Can I help you? It might have sounded professional if she wasn't chewing gum in the style of Julia Roberts' wisecracking prostitute friend in Pretty Woman. Actually, she's not unlike her. Except Marina is not a prostitute. Can I speak with Melanie Sweet Bitter, please? Melody Bittersweet, Marina corrects. You can't be that interested in speaking to her if you don't even know her name. I clear my throat and cross the room to stand beside Marina. We watch the toweringly tall, awkward boy on the doorstep turn an unattractive shade of beetroot as he roots around in the inside pocket of his ill-fitting suit jacket. He pulls out a letter I recognize and shakes it open. Arthur Elliot. He looks like a much younger, paler version of his ruddy-cheeked father. Melody Bittersweet, he says, his nervous grey eyes flicking between us. Marina cocks her head towards me as I step forward and hold my hand out. I'm Melody. I try to fill my voice with easy confidence as I shake his clammy hand. You must be Arthur. Come on in. I step back to make room for him to come inside and have to yank Marina back by the arm when she stays in place, blocking the doorway. Shouldn't we have a password?
She hisses at me as Arthur edges uncertainly past us.
What like?
I say out of the corner of my mouth. She shrugs, closing the door.
I don't know. Donuts? Limoncello bubbers?
I hold in a laugh.
Behave yourself. You're going to scare people off. Says the one who sees dead people.
Arthur is hovering by the desk, listening to us, his eyes as round as footballs.
Have I come at a bad time?
The panic in his whispery croak suggests that he thinks he has come at a very bad time indeed, and would like to leave right away. No, no. Come and sit down, Arthur. You're right on time.
I am?
If anything, he looks even more disconcerted to hear that he's on time for an appointment he didn't even know he had. Marina steps forward and swings the swivel chair in front of the desk around to Arthur. He swallows hard, as if there's a chance it's electrified, and then lowers his lanky frame into it and licks his lips.
Water?
I ask, walking around the desk and taking my seat. The boy nods. I'm not surprised. He looks as if he's about to pass out. Marina, could you grab Arthur a glass of water, please?
Whiskey in it?
She jokes, looking at him, and he shakes his head slowly.
Oh, I only drink beer. 2 cans, on a Friday, with my dad.
His eyes suddenly fill with tears, and Marina looks stricken. I lower my eyes and give him a second to gather himself. That water? I prompt Marina, and she pats Arthur on the shoulder as she disappears in search of a glass. That's the thing about Marina. She's full of wisecracks, everybody's funny girl, but there's a sentimental vein that runs through her to the core. She sat beside me and cried while Kate Winslet pulled that old guy around the swimming pool, while I stuck my fingers down my throat and fake gagged into the popcorn. You get the idea.
You sent me a letter?
Arthur said, looking at his lap. I did. I heard that you might be the right person for a job that's come up here. He looks up at last, but the expression in his eyes tells me that he doesn't believe me.
You heard from who?
God, sticky wicket. I can hardly tell him that his dad came to see me in his high-vis jacket and talked me into offering his son a job, can I?
Friend,
I try, and his eyes grow even more troubled. Ah, that's right. He doesn't have friends.
An old teacher?
He shakes his head, and I remember his father's words about Arthur bunking off.
You know, I can't remember,
I say, waving my hand vaguely in the air. Let's talk about the job, and it'll probably come back to me. He looks at me warily, still unconvinced. It's not much, I say, because I haven't actually thought about what the job will be.
Helping out around here, learning the ropes, and coming with me on assignments out in the, field.
He glances at his super shiny black lace-ups.
Will I need to buy some wellies?
I frown at him.
For the fields,
he explains.
Oh, no, I smile. Sorry, Arthur. I meant out in the field, as in when I go out to visit clients in their homes, or buildings, or, wherever their problem is.
But not in fields?
I shake my head. No fields. He runs a finger around the inside of his shirt collar and gratefully accepts the glass of water that Marina has returned with. He knocks the whole thing back in one go and then hands her the empty glass.
Thank you,
he says.
And you won't need to wear a suit, I smile. We like to keep things casual around here.
I realize I sound like I'm quoting from a 70s handbook of how to be a hipster boss for buttoned-up people who don't have a clue. Marina nods.
Yeah, casual. Dress down Fridays, wear pink Wednesdays, naked Tuesdays.
She throws in jazz hands for good measure, because she clearly doesn't feel that she's terrified poor Arthur enough. His sudden coughing fit suggests otherwise.
She's just kidding, I say quickly. She's like this all the time. You'll get used to her.
I have. The letter. It said trainee ghost hunter,
Arthur says, finding his voice at last.
That's right, I say. The agency is very new, but it's our aim to help people who feel that their property is, for want of a better phrase, haunted.
And we do what?
Well, my eyes dart a silent warning at Marina to let me do the talking. We go in, find out if there are any ghosts in there, and if there are, we figure out what they want and hopefully resolve the issue so they can move on. Arthur's gaze never leaves my face as I speak.
How will we know if there are ghosts or not?
I clear my throat. Okay, so don't freak out, but I can see them. He jumps inside his jacket and looks at me as if I've grown an extra head.
With special ghost hunting goggles?
I shake my head. No, Arthur. I see them with my eyes, and I hear them with my ears. I'm a normal person, just like you, except that I can see and talk to dead people. I speak in a low, measured voice, and he takes it all in.
And you too?
His gaze slides to Marina, who barks with laughter at the suggestion. No way, Jose! Bruce Willis over there is on her own with that one. Arthur pauses.
You know it wasn't Bruce Willis who could see dead people in that movie.
I admire him for having the balls to correct Marina. Maybe there's hope for him yet. He looks back at me and the flare of hope in his eyes is unmissable.
And you can teach me to see dead people too?
I'm afraid that isn't something you can be taught, I say tactfully. You either do or you don't. I don't choose to be able to do it. I just can. All of my family can. Arthur looks as if a light bulb has suddenly gone on in his head.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.